Welcome, everyone. It's been, I think, 6-7 years ago since we did it, this session the last time. So for us, it's a bit strange as well to be up on stage again together. Well, at least I'm going to be up first. My name is Duncan Epping. I'm a chief technologist working for the storage and availability business unit. I'm going to present together with Frank. And Frank is a chief technologist working for the cloud platform business unit and primarily focuses on resource management. So I'm going to do the HA part. Frank is going to cover the DRS part. There's a disclaimer here. I'm not going to talk about the disclaimer because we're going to focus on stuff that's way more important. We're not going to talk about any futures. We're going to talk about things that are important today. We're going to talk about how to protect your workloads against particular kind of failures, or how to ensure that your workloads are actually getting the resources they require or they demand. So this is the agenda. I'm going to start with HA, as already mentioned. I'm going to do a couple of basics. Then I'm going to do a deep dive. And what I'm actually going to do in this particular case is I'm not going to use a lot of diagrams. I realize there's a lot of geeks and nerds in the room. So I'm going to use a lot of log files to show you how you can actually troubleshoot an environment yourself, how you can figure out what has happened to your environment when a virtual machine has been restarted, why it has been restarted. So all of that information is part of this, this deck. Then Frank is going to take over, and he's going to talk about the basics of DRS. And then he's going to talk about some of the more advanced features, when you should be using them and when you shouldn't be using them. So let's get started. I see a bunch of old faces, a lot of people that I actually remember or recall from previous versions of the session. But who recalls what an HA event looked like before VMware? Who still recalls what that looks like? Not too many people. Well, let me remind you. Before we had VMware, this is what you had to do when something happened to a host. And for those who haven't been around for that long, this is a tape. And if something failed in your data center, HA didn't just restart a virtual machine or a physical machine. We didn't have that option. No, you actually had to go into the data center, figure out if you had extra hardware laying around. If you were lucky, you had hardware laying around. If you were unlucky, it had to be fixed. So you had to wait for an engineer to come in to fix the host. Then you get your tapes, then you probably wait for 8, 12 hours, whatever it was, and then if you were lucky, you would have all of your data back and the application was up and running again. Well, luckily for us, the world has changed, and it changed a lot. Probably 80% of you, and probably more in the audience, is using HA and DRS. For HA, the number is actually higher. It's about 90, 92%. For DRS, it's slightly lower, and that's because it's part of a different licensing SKU. It's part of the Enterprise Plus licensing SKU, so that's why we see a slight difference between HA and DRS. But some of you may wonder, okay, you know, it's 80% or maybe 90 and 92% for HA. What are the 8% of the people doing that are not using HA? Well, in some cases, people are doing things like cloud native applications. Most of the cloud native applications have their own high availability mechanism, so they don't need HA in that particular case. Some of you may be doing VDI with instant on desktops, where when you need a desktop, it's instantly provisioned. So in that particular case, you don't need HA either. So there are some use cases where you don't need it. For everyone else in the room, make sure you enable it. And I'm going to go over the different options you have within HA itself to optimize it for your particular environment. So let's cover some of the basics. Well, this is probably something that everyone knows. If you don't know this, you probably ended up in the wrong room, I'm guessing. But if you look at this, it's fairly straightforward. HA does a couple of things. There are a couple of things here that you may not know. First of all, if a host fails, HA responds to that by simply restarting the virtual machine. And you know, that's what probably most of us have seen over the past couple of years happening. The other thing that HA can respond to as well is the loss of storage connectivity. So if anything has happened to the network between the host and the storage system, HA can respond to that. Also, we can respond to particular storage failures itself. On top of that, we can also respond to a guest operating system failure or even an application failure. This is not used by a lot of people, but we have that capability within HA. If the guest OS has a blue screen of that, HA can respond to that. So we have those features available within the platform. So how does that work? Well, it's fairly straightforward. These are still the basics, but it's useful to know. Because when you start doing troubleshooting, you realize that it's typically the network that is causing the issue. Are there many network administrators, by the way, in this room before I piss off half of the audience? Okay, not too, well, only a couple. We can take them on, so that's okay. But if you look at this and you look at this diagram, you realize that we have this thing called a heartbeat. And a heartbeat is basically what helps informing the cluster what the status is of the cluster. So we have a couple of nodes in this particular case. We have three nodes. In an HA cluster, you'll always end up with one master node and multiple slaves. So if you have 32 nodes, you will have one master node and 31 slaves. The slaves will inform the master about the status of their particular ESXi instance. It uses the heartbeat network for that. So it sends out a heartbeat to the master itself. It informs the master that it's alive, and the heartbeat then indicates to the master itself that it doesn't need to take action. If anything happens to the network, we've got another mechanism that we can use, and that's the data store. This is called data store heartbeating. So if you've configured HA, you've probably seen that option, data store heartbeating, and the data store is actually being used to inform the master what has happened to a particular slave if something has happened to the network. So if the network has failed, then we can still use the storage layer to actually figure out what we need to do with the virtual machines. So we have two different options here. One thing to point out for those who are vSAN customers, if you're using vSAN, we don't use the management network for the heartbeats. We leverage the vSAN network. This is really important. We're going to talk about isolation and isolation addresses later on. Then you will see why it's important, because we use a different network. We also need to make sure we use different IP addresses, potentially a different gateway or whatever it is. We'll come back to that in a second. Now, if you go to the configuration interface, this is typically what it looks like. It's fairly straightforward, but you see a couple of different options. And all of these with all of these different options, you can more or less put a policy in place or an insurance in place against a particular failure. So for instance, you can specify that if a host fails, that you need to restart that particular virtual machine that was running on that particular host. You can also specify that if anything has happened to the network, that you now would like to restart that particular virtual machine that was running on that particular host. This is called a host isolation response. On top of that, you can, for instance, specify what needs to happen during a failure of a storage device. So you have all of these different options in the UI. But we have more than that. In 6.5, we actually introduced a couple of additional features. So out of the audience, who is already running vSphere 6.5? It's actually a really big number, so I'm really happy to see that. Hopefully, all of you have seen the new functionality that is part of vSphere 6.5 as well. Let's go over it fairly quick. The first thing that we introduced was a change in restart priorities. When we did this session in the past, I would always tell people, you know, the restart priorities are kind of useless because you have three different levels, and those three different levels only indicated when we would schedule the restart of the virtual machine. So what does that mean? If a host had failed and we have 60 virtual machines running on that particular host with three different priority levels in the past, HA would quickly start scheduling those 32 at a time, or per host 32 at a time, and the level would indicate when they would be scheduled for a restart on the other host. But the restart literally happens within milliseconds. So that meant, in terms of priority, if you had small virtual machines, large virtual machines, and different assigned with different priorities, they probably would all power on at the same time. That would also mean that large database, for instance, that you would like to have powered on as the first virtual machine, probably takes the longest to power on. So it was kind of useless to use the priorities in the past. However, we changed this whole mechanism in 6.5. If you now use this mechanism, first of all, we have five different levels. We had low, medium, and high. We now added lowest and highest. I know it's from a naming perspective, it's kind of weird, but we wanted to make sure that from a compatibility standpoint, if you're doing some form of scripting, you could still use the APIs in the same way. So that's why we added lowest and highest. But the more important thing is that you now can specify when the next batch needs to start. Is that, for instance, when the resources are allocated? That was the original option that we had, purely the scheduling part. Is that when the virtual machine has actually been powered on, so when the VMX has been started and you can see the power on happening within vCenter? Or for instance, do we need to wait until the guest heartbeat comes in from VMware Tools? This is very similar to what you have with something like Site Recovery Manager. So if you want to do some form of orchestration, you can actually now start doing that. You can specify this particular database machine needs to be powered on before the application virtual machine needs to be powered on simply by using these priorities and specifying the guest heartbeat. On top of that, if you're using application monitoring, VM and application monitoring, you can also specify that you need to wait for a particular service to be powered on. So that could also be very useful, depending on what type of applications you are running. The cool thing here is that if you have multiple of these batches, so let's say you're using all five of these different priority groups, if one of the virtual machines doesn't power on, we're not going to wait just infinitely. What we're going to do is there's going to be a timeout, and it runs for about 600 seconds. So after 10 minutes, we'll start the next batch, regardless of what happened in that previous batch, just to ensure your VMs will power on. So that's something that is new in 6.5. The other thing that we introduced in 6.5, and the confusing part here is that it sounds really similar, is something that is called restart dependencies. The previous one was restart priorities, and this is dependencies. And the big difference here is that you actually use the DRS rules, or the HA DRS rules, I should say, to specify what the dependency is between different groups. So you create a VM to host group, and then you specify group A needs to wait on group B to be powered on. So if group B has been powered on, group A can now continue. That's how it basically works. The big difference here is this. First of all, it's called a mandatory rule. This is a hard rule. So we're always going to wait, even if a single virtual machine cannot be restarted. So if you have a lot of virtual machines in these particular groups and something doesn't power on, it will get confusing really fast. So that's why I tell customers use the priority instead of the restart dependency. The other thing here as well is that you can only have a dependency between two different groups. So you can say group A is dependent on group B. You can't say group A, B, C, D, E. That's something that you can do with restart priorities. If, however, you have the need for a more granular level, this is something that you could use. But preferably use the priorities, don't use the restart dependency for now. I can tell you, though, that we have a discussion with the HA team, and they're looking to make this a bit more flexible in the future. So hopefully in the future, we can say that this is a soft rule instead of a hard rule. It's something that we are working on. So let's start moving towards the more deeper dive part, because I realize that most of you people are probably here for the geeky stuff. So before we get started, before we start talking about restarts, we need to know what mechanism we have to ensure that we have resources available to restart a virtual machine. In the past, when we had these types of sessions, a lot of our customers weren't using admission control. So let me ask the question, is anyone not using admission control right now? A couple of hands, okay. Hopefully I can convince you guys to start leveraging admission control. There are some reasons why you may not use it, and I think a lot of customers that are not using it today are probably not using it because of a lot of the misconceptions that we had over the past couple of years, right? We had a lot of challenges. First of all, we have three different admission control algorithms. The percentage-based, the slot-based, and then there's the failover host. Now, I strike through the failover host because it probably doesn't apply to the majority view. Why not? Well, with a failover host, you actually designate a specific host to not being used in the cluster itself actively, but only being used for failover. So if you have DRS running, DRS is not going to consider that particular host to place virtual machines on, which means you have one single host sitting there idle. This is not the reason why you created a cluster in the first place. So I usually don't recommend customers to use it. We have some customers using it for compliancy reasons, typically, because they always need to know what a particular virtual machine is running. So in that particular case, you can use this. In all other use cases, go for the percentage-based or the slot-based algorithm. And I would say always go for the percentage-based algorithm, because it's the most flexible one of these two. The slot-based algorithm is what most people actually used historically speaking. So back in the days, this was the default option, so everyone used the slot-based mechanism. But what a lot of people started realizing quickly is that when you had a single large reservation for memory set, for instance, it would skew the algorithm. The slot-based algorithm is fairly straightforward. It looks at the largest reservation of any virtual machine in your cluster, and it says that that's the slot size. What it then does, it looks at the amount of resources that are available within the cluster, and it divides it by the slot size. So if you have a virtual machine with a 32 gig reservation, for instance, right, and you only have 120 gigs worth of memory, the amount of slots available within your cluster is not that high. And now when you start powering on virtual machines, every single virtual machine, even if it only has 1 gig of memory, will consume a single slot, which means that HA will assume that it's going to use 32 gigs of memory somehow magically, which it can't because it only has 1 gig of memory assigned to it. That's why I always tell customers, go with the percentage based, because with the percentage based, what we actually do is we look at the amount of resources reserved for every single virtual machine and take that into consideration during the calculations. It's a lot more flexible. Now, the challenge that people then typically have is when they've enabled this, the next question always is, okay, that's great, but we're talking about reservations here. I'm guessing that the majority of you are probably not using reservations, and if you are, you're probably using reservations on a couple of virtual machines. So what about the demand of a virtual machine? Can you take that into consideration as well? And actually, you can. In 6.5, we released a new feature which is called performance degradation VMs tolerate. So what does that mean? With this particular feature, you can now specify the amount of performance you are willing, a performance degradation you are willing to tolerate during a failure. In this particular case, it's set to 100%, which means we don't take it into consideration. But if you set it to 50%, what we're going to do then is we're going to look at the amount of resources that you have available, the amount of resources your virtual machines are demanding, we deduct it by 50%, and if you're under the threshold, we'll leave you alone. But if you're above the threshold, so you're exceeding this particular number, we're going to inform you about this and tell you, hey, you know what, if something happens to your environment, if you specify 2 host failures, right, if something happens in this particular case, your virtual machines may get less resources than they are requiring today, which means that from a service level agreement perspective, you may be violating the SLA you had with your business unit. So this is a feature that not a lot of people are using today, but it is a feature that I would encourage you to start looking at when you get back after VMworld. Right? Look at your environment, see if you have this set up. If you haven't set it up, start specifying a percentage and see what it does. Now, let's go to the more geeky part, because this is what HA is all about, and it's about the failure scenarios. So we're going to go over the different failure scenarios that there are, and I'm going to discuss the host failure first, because this is probably the most common failure scenarios. Everyone has seen this in the past. A host has failed, virtual machines are being restarted, and now someone phones you up and says, okay, what has happened? You need to figure out what has happened. So what do you look at? Well, there's one log file you can look at. It's called the FDM log. It's stored in var/log, where most of the log files are being stored. And if you start looking at this particular log file, you can actually figure out what has happened pretty quick. Well, that is if you know what to look at, if you know at what keywords to look at, because there's a lot of information in this particular log file. So what I had to do in this particular case is when I introduced the failure is write down the specific time where I introduced the failure to figure out what the keywords were. But let's have a look what HA actually does and how it works. First of all, when a host has failed, on the master itself, we'll start marking the host as being unreachable, meaning that in this particular case, there are no heartbeats being received by that from that particular host, from that particular slave. We're not receiving any heartbeats anymore. So what do we do next? Well, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to check the data store. I've already mentioned we have this thing called data store heartbeating, and we can use that to figure out what has happened to a particular host. So we're going to check the data store, and we're going to see if there are any particular heartbeats coming in from that particular host. On top of that, what HA does is it's also going to send a ping to the host itself. Now, you may ask yourself, why would you send a ping to the host? Well, you can imagine that if the HA service has failed, the network heartbeats are not going to work, plus the storage heartbeats won't be working anymore either. But in that particular case, if only the HA service has failed, the virtual machines are probably still running, so we don't need to restart them, right? So we're also going to check for that. Now, after we've done that, and we've waited for 15 seconds, and no data store heartbeat has been received, the pings haven't been returned either, and we haven't seen any heartbeats from the slave itself over the network coming in, we're going to specify that this particular host has died. So I'm going to say the host is dead. It has been declared dead. The next thing that we'll do then is we'll read the protection list. We'll figure out which virtual machines were running on that particular host. and what the status was of those particular virtual machines. Were they powered off? Were they powered on? What was the status of the virtual machines? So what do we need to do with the virtual machines? And if we know what to do with the virtual machines, we're going to send that information to the different hosts that are still available in the cluster to ensure that the virtual machines will be powered on. Now, the interesting thing here is all the way at the bottom, it says invoke DRS algorithm for placement. This is something that not a lot of people actually realize, but the HA solution actually has its own DRS algorithm baked in. So it can figure out where to start your virtual machines based on the statistics that were available over the past 10 or 15 minutes. Right? So it places them in a smart way as well. It's not just a shotgun approach. It places them in a smart way. So hopefully that's clear for everyone. This is the host failure. Now let's have a look at other options, because I was picking on the network people before, but we all know that storage also fails occasionally. Right? I see a couple people shaking their heads. I know they work for a vendor, so I know the reason. But it happens. There's a couple of different options, of course. There are a couple of different things that could fail. First of all, you could have something that is called a permanent device loss. And a permanent device loss, in most cases, means that the storage administrator has made a change to the masking, for instance, of the LUN. So the access to the LUN has been revoked. And now what happens is a SCSI sense code is sent to the ESXi host. The ESXi host picks up the SCSI sense code, terminates the virtual machine, and restarts it on the host that has access to the storage. So it has that capability. We also have the option to prevent or to respond to an APD, which is an all paths down scenario. And this is where the network between the data store and the host has failed for whatever reason. In that particular case, we can also take action. The interesting thing here is that it takes about 5 minutes roughly before you see a restart happening. So why is that? Well, we need to wait for the APD timer to pass, which is 140 seconds. And then there's an additional 3 minutes for HA itself, where it waits for 3 minutes before it starts restarting virtual machines. So that is something to take into consideration when you start leveraging this. Now, of course, the 3 minutes for HA is something that you can configure. If you would like it to be 60 seconds, you can specify that in the UI. You have that option available. So what does it look like? Well, for this, the log files are a bit more difficult, because there's a couple of different log files you should be looking at. First of all, there's the FDM log in the host, for instance, where the PDL has occurred. So this is the permanent device loss case. So in this particular case, you can see that the device itself is marked as inaccessible instantly. This is because we received that SCSI sense code. So we received the SCSI sense code. We know what has happened to the device. It's not available, so we know we can start taking action. On top of that, what we will do is we will add the device to a list that actually specifies that that particular device is unavailable for that particular host. So if anything else happens in the cluster, we're not going to use that particular host to restart virtual machines that are stored on that particular device. I'm going to come back to that in a second. The other place where you can look at is the Veeam kernel log. Most of you probably looked at the Veeam kernel log before, right? And we actually declare these PDLs in the Veeam kernel log as well. You can do that on the host where the PDL has occurred. So it's pretty easy to identify. On top of that, you can also look at the FDM log of the master, because of course there will also specify that something has happened to that particular data store. Not only will we specify that something has happened to the data store, we'll also start specifying that we need to start taking action. So in this particular case, we'll specify that VM component protection has detected a failure to that particular data store, and we'll specify that we're going to terminate the virtual machine. So if you see this virtual machine disappearing and you want to know why it has disappeared, you can find out by looking at this particular log file. It will mention that it has been terminated. On top of that, of course, after it has been terminated, we'll send the placement recommendations to the available hosts in the cluster, and we'll start taking action immediately. Fairly straightforward. The other cool thing is that if you're doing some form of troubleshooting, we have this thing called PrettyPrint, and with PrettyPrint, you can start figuring out which virtual machine can be restarted on which particular host. It's fairly straightforward. You type PrettyPrint.sh via metadata, and now you can see a compatibility matrix, and that compatibility matrix actually lists which virtual machines can be restarted on which particular hosts. So if a failure has occurred and you want to figure out why a virtual machine has not been restarted, typically this is how you can find out why it hasn't been restarted, because it usually means that the data store is not available, the network port group was not available, or there were other reasons, but it's usually specified in this particular list. The all pods down scenario is, as I just explained, the scenario where the network is failed between the host and the data store. Now, as I mentioned, this is slightly different because ESXi doesn't know what has happened. The network has simply disappeared. The data store is gone. It's specified as inaccessible, but we don't know what has happened. So we can't immediately take action. We actually need to wait. We will send a notification to all of the hosts in the cluster that something has happened, though, simply to ensure that we're not going to try to restart virtual machines on that particular host. But this is the more interesting thing. On the VM kernel log, you can actually see that the APD state has been entered. More importantly, you can actually see when we have reached the APD state. So this is when 140 seconds has passed. 140 seconds has passed. It has now been declared as failed. And that means that HA can start taking action. So in this particular case, we know we need to start taking action. We're going to exclude a particular host that does not have access to that particular data store from the list. So we're not going to restart the virtual machine on that particular host, but we'll make sure that we can start taking action on the other host by first terminating the virtual machines, then sending them for placement, and of course, powering on the virtual machines. Now, pretty straightforward, and hopefully, you know, this will help you guys in the future to start doing some form of troubleshooting. And then there's one more scenario, and this is always a discussion because a lot of people don't realize that there's a big difference between a host isolation and host and a host partition or hosts partitioning. So what is the big difference? Well, I'm going to discuss that on the next slide, but first of all, before we get into that, if you want to ensure that a virtual machine is being restarted during an isolation, make sure you specify the isolation response. A lot of customers don't have this specified. If you would like to ensure that a virtual machine is being restarted when the network has dropped, specify that with an UI by saying the virtual machine needs to be shut down and restarted on another host. You have that ability. On top of that, specify an isolation address as well. And make sure that if you're using vSAN, that this isolation address is actually on the vSAN network, because otherwise we'll be using a different network to try to ping that particular interface, and it will make it very difficult to identify what the situation actually is. But let's talk about the isolation versus the partition, because this is important. What's the difference? In the case of an isolation, it's a single host that is separated from the rest of the cluster. If that happens, so that's the left side for you guys, if that happens, the host is going to declare itself isolated and is going to take action by killing the virtual machine or restarting the virtual machine. For a partition, this is different, because with a partition, we have multiple hosts that are now no longer part of that rest of the cluster, but they will form their own subcluster. They will have their own master, and they're not going to kill the virtual machines. They're not going to restart the virtual machine. So with an isolation, there will be a certain action. With a partition, there's probably not going to be an action. So that is something that is important to realize. So let's take a look at the log files. In this particular case, the top bottom is what happens on the slave. The bottom part is what happens in the case of the master. First of all, the host, the slave host, is going to ping the isolation address. So this is something that you specify. It's going to be the default gateway, or it's going to be the IP address that you specify in the advanced settings. We're going to try to ping that. If we can't ping it for whatever reason, we're going to specify that we are isolated. And what we're going to do next is we're going to trigger the isolation response, but more importantly is we're going to provide that information through the data store to the master node itself, because now the master knows that this particular host has been isolated. So on the master node, because the heartbeats are not coming in, what we're going to do next is all of the other things that we did in the host failure scenario as well, right? We're going to check the heartbeats, and we're going to try to ping them, but quickly we will identify that a heartbeat has been received. So instead of declaring the particular host failed or dead, we now know that the host is actually alive, but the difference here is that the host is isolated. So we now know that we probably need to do something with the virtual machine. So what we're going to do next is we're going to look at the heartbeat, and we're going to identify all of the virtual machines that were powered off as a result of this particular isolation case. And if we know which virtual machines have been isolated, then we can simply start restarting those virtual machines. Fairly straightforward, in my opinion at least, if you know what to look for. So hopefully this will help you guys in the future to start identifying what has happened in an environment. And then last but not least, I think the only thing that's better better than recovering from a failure is simply preventing a failure from occurring. And we have this feature available since 6.5, and it actually allows you, it's called Proactive HA, but it is a feature that was implemented by the DRS team, and it actually is a DRS feature. And what this allows you to do is simply specify what should happen if a host is degraded from a hardware perspective. If something has happened to the memory, something has happened to a NIC, something has happened to a power supply, you can now start taking action by placing that host in maintenance mode, or what we call quarantine mode. And quarantine mode prevents virtual machines from being placed on that particular host by DRS. Maintenance mode simply moves all of the virtual machines of that particular host. So hopefully that is clear. I know a lot of customers are not using this yet. If you're not using it yet and you have DRS available in your environment, I would highly recommend to start looking at Proactive HA, because it will make your life a lot easier. And we're going, and with that, we're going to move over to the DRS part of the talk. Frank?
So I hope that Duncan, good morning everybody, by the way.
Afternoon.
Afternoon already, wow. Time zone differences, I think. So I hope Duncan didn't fry your brain. Actually, he was talking about 6 years that we did our last session, so I thought it would be cool to actually wear the same t-shirt as the latest, as the last one. I see Neil's thinking, did he wash it? Yes, I did wash it, so that's a good thing. So let's talk about the past. We announced or released DRS in 2006. So back when virtualization started, we were coming off mainframes and we were entering an x86 sprawl. Everybody got their own server, right? And it was like an Oprah episode. You get a server, you get a server, everybody got a server. But then we discovered that there was low utilization. And on average, 48% of those servers were actually utilized on active utilization. So that's where server consolidation came into fruition, and that's what made us so popular, right? One server, many applications, right? So that active part is very important to the DRS algorithm. So consolidation of a numerous workload that is based on activity. So when you look at the metrics of DRS, you can see that active is the main source. For CPU, it's ready time, run, and peak. That's the active part. And for memory, it's a little bit more, because memory can be stored in the working set and need to be addressed or need to be consumed rather quickly. So we have a portion that is active memory, and we have a portion that is consumed memory and idle as well. So these two actually depend or decide whether your virtual machine is eligible for load balancing. Does it get the resources it needs, right? Now, the whole idea of DRS is we want to give the application the best resources or the most resources it demands. But when we move virtual machines to other hosts, we are actually consuming those resources ourselves, or DRS it does, right? So you need to move the memory. So there's some CPU involved. There's some network bandwidth involved, right? We need to actually allocate the resources on another host. So there are some costs involved and some risk, because from a cost perspective, it's how much memory do I need to transfer over? Now, you can look at the size of the memory, of the consumed memory, but you also need to take into account the volatility. Right? You can have an idle virtual machine with a lot of memory consumed. That's a far better candidate to move than a small one that is constantly refreshing its memory. And that's the risk, right? If I want to move over, how long will it take? Do I need to send over the deltas over and over again? So the cost, benefit, and risk analysis is the main part whether DRS starts to move or not, particularly based on activity. But we're now living in 2018, and things changed, right? It's not all about consolidation anymore. It's about mobility. It's about automation. It's a small part of the whole VMware ecosystem. So I did a poll on Twitter, and I asked, so are you actually consuming, or are you actually looking at activity, or are you deploying a cluster based on full memory backup? So by show of hands, as who designs their cluster based on consumed memory? So basically what I mean to say is, if I have 20 VMs and they are allocated 32 gigs, do I actually look at the configuration size of things, or do I look at the activity? How many of you do the consume things? Okay. So in 6.5, we looked at this and we gave you three new options. And the first one I want to talk to you about is memory metric for load balancing. So what's that? So when you have a virtual machine, you create a virtual machine. Let's say it's a 16 gig virtual machine. So you have configured memory that's on the right side, that's 16 gigs. But that virtual machine is actually consuming memory. That's 12 gigs. But out of that 12 gigs, 5.5 gigs are actually active, right? Now DRS looks at the active part. But now you designed your cluster for consumed. So there's a mismatch. What the normal DRS algorithm does, it says, I'm using active memory and a slight portion of the consumed memory. That's what we call idle consumed. We use 25%. We do that for spikes. But that's normally not enough if you design your cluster for consumed memory, right? So by using that additional option, what we do is we use the full consumed memory. So now it starts to load balance based on the actual consumed memory, right? So that aligns more with your design of your cluster. In the UI, we actually have a new metric that shows the difference between active and consumed. So now you have a better way of looking at your cluster and seeing how many virtual machines or what your virtual machines are actually consuming, right? So it gives you an idea whether you should toggle that option or not. But please note, this is not admission control, right? DRS will allow you to power on multiple virtual machines, even if you use that particular setting. So one thing that a lot of people think about when they look at DRS, and that's the stuff that I hear from most customers, you're not looking at ready time. Well, yes and no, right? So these are the metrics that are used for the allocation part of DRS. Allocation is the metric used to identify it's the main metric to load balance, right? To see whether or not the resources are satisfied, or what we like to call the VM happiness. Now, as you can see, ready is a part of it. So we take it into consideration, but what we don't do is we load balance on that particular metric. We don't do like, oh, this virtual machine has a high ready time, I need to load balance it, right? It's just a part of the allocation metric. So we have aggressive CPU active for that. But I want to stress this really, really badly. Test this one first if you think about this. And somewhere other than your production environment, of course. So on the left side, you see the normal way of how DRS works. It takes, per 5 minutes, it takes 1 minute, and it looks at the average of those five metrics. So what you see is one virtual machine in the last 5 minutes had an average of 50, 70, 10, 5, and 5. If you add them up, and if you divide them by 5, you get an average of 28%. That's the allocation, right? But if you use the 80 percentile, you will see that the second highest metric is actually 50%. And by using this advanced feature, we will look at the 80 percentile metric. So it will load balance more on the spikiness of the application, if you want to call it like that. So another one that is interesting is the top one, and that's VM distribution. One of the things that we hear a lot from customers is that I have 20 hosts, but if you look closely, there are 20 VMs on 10 hosts, and there are 10 VMs on 5 hosts, and there are a couple of VMs on the rest, right? So it's an unequal distribution. And if I show this to my management, they don't get it why it's not equally balanced. I want to have the same amount of VMs on the same on every host, because when a host fails, I will reduce my impact. Now we have this option, which is called VM distribution. So it will like, it wants to peanut butter spread your VMs across the cluster, but it will look at the VM happiness first. It doesn't say I have 100 virtual machines on 10 hosts, so that means I need to have 10 VMs per host. It looks at what is the allocation, what is the best distribution of the VMs I can get. And you can see it in the name of the advanced setting. It's called try balance VMs per host. So it does an attempt. It's a best effort. But when you add this feature, or when you enable this one, you will see a better distribution of VMs per host. And the cool part is you can actually combine those two, right? So setting the memory metric for load balancing is based on the consumed, and then you enable the VM distribution, and you get a better distribution as well. Typically, you use this for IP-based storage systems or network traffic distribution. Now, the last additional option I want to talk to you about is the PC, the CPU overcommit. Now, depending on the client that you're using, either the H5 client or the web client, who's using the web client? Okay, so you get a different response than the default H5 client, right? When you use the H5 client, the HTML5 client, we use the advanced setting max vCPU per core. And you can have a minimum value of 4 and a maximum value of 32. So what you basically are configuring is that a CPU can have 5 to 32 vCPUs per physical core. Now, when you use the web client, you get a different behavior. What we do is we use the setting max vCPU per cluster percentage. And we have a minimum value of 0, and which is really bad, because 0 means no, and a maximum value of 5. That means you can have a max of 5 vCPU per physical core, right? Now this is, I have to admit, kind of weird to have two different settings or two different behaviors of the same setting. So we're going to fix this in a future release, right? But think about this: if I want to have a low consolidation ratio, use the web client for that. If you want a little bit higher, use the HTML5 client for that, right? Something has changed under the hood in 6.5, and that's called pairwise behavior. So based on the slide of the aggressiveness of your DRS, we will start to look at the difference between the load of the host. And what we'll do is we'll say, for example, with the default behavior, we will say that one host, the least loaded host and the highest loaded host cannot be different than 20%. If it's more than 20%, we need to load balance again, right? So it doesn't look at allocation and the VM happiness, it just looks at the overall load as well. So it has some sort of VM distribution part in it as well. Now, with the migration threshold level set to 1, we don't do it. Why? Because there's no load balancing involved anyways, right? From the beginning, 1 means mandatory moves. Do I set my VM or do I set my host to maintenance mode? That's when I'm going to migrate my VMs to another host. That's the primary reason. Am I violating a affinity rule? I'm going to migrate my VMs. That's it. That's what DRS does when you set it to 1, right? So if you want to have the least aggressive load balancing, set it to 2, because 1 won't give you any load balancing. So I made a diagram because Duncan didn't want to make diagrams. And now you can see that 2 hosts, ESX1 and ESX5, are more than 20% different from a load balancing, from a utilization perspective. So we're going to load balance some VMs. But here's the thing. We're not restricted to load balance from these 2 hosts. We can migrate virtual machines to other hosts, between other hosts, to make the overall load balance or the overall utilization in the cloud better, right? Another thing we announced is network-aware DRS. Now, notice that we're not saying network DRS because we're not load balancing on network specific. It's better to view it as a filter. So what we do is we go through the same algorithm of finding out which host is utilized to which percentage, and then we're going to rack them and stack them and rank them, basically. And we're going to see which VM we need to move to another host. And at that point, we're going to look at the utilization of its network devices. So it's a refinement, if you want to call it like that. If one host is utilized heavily on the network perspective, it doesn't mean we're going to load balance, right? It's not a primary citizen within the metrics. Now, one thing you want to be aware of is that we take all the NICs, physical NICs of the host into account to understand the network utilization. So if you have an environment that is divided from distributed from a switch perspective, so you have 2 NICs assigned to switch 0, which uses the management network and the IP storage network, and you have another vSwitch that is solely directed or solely designed to use a VM network, this feature will be less efficient, right? Because typically you don't see a lot of activity on your management network, but it does count to the overall network utilization. If you have the design on the right, you have a far better chance whether this network-aware DRS is more efficient, right? The last thing I want to talk to you about is predictive DRS. Now, think about what I said about the consumed memory and designing your cluster for that. So instead of looking at activity, I'm looking at consumed, right? That's a far more relaxed way of load balancing, and you will see a less number or a lower number of migrations going on, But there are some moments where you know, or where actually the algorithm knows, when spike occurs. So when you have a seasonal workload or a weekly workload, right? On Monday morning, it will spike up. Or every Thursday, bi-weekly, because of the salary slip generation, we will see a particular workload spike up. What we can do is we can enable DRS to actually consume the metrics from VROPs to understand how the workload trends. So you just have to enable two settings, and I think it's a little bit unclear. But you, in DRS, you have to enable predictive DRS, and in VROPs, you have to set it to true. And from that point on, DRS starts to consume the metrics from VROPs, and it will look at the overall trend. And when it knows whether a virtual machine will spike its activity, it's going to load balance the cluster in order to make sure that VM will get the resources it needs. Right? So it's a much more smarter way. And it's a really easy way to configure this. Just by setting two options, you have a far more smarter environment. Right? And with that, I want to open the mics for some questions for us. In the meantime, am I saying it right? 5 o'clock? 5 o'clock this afternoon, we will be giving away, or actually Rubrik will be giving away books, the Clustering Deep Dive. So we have a signing session at the Rubrik booth at 5 o'clock. Come all, I would say, and you can get a book. Do you want to come outside? Any questions? Can you go come to the mic?
And thanks recorded. Everyone for thanks. Attending, by the way, before you leave.
Yeah, Gilbert and Edwin and that's all in our team stuff, yeah.
Yeah, my question is, what does it mean on the predictive DRS that it won't trade in for VM happiness? Is it like a second class citizen as well, or what does that mean?
So when we know there's a spike with the workload, we want to move it, or we want to clear out the cluster in case, so in a way that it can actually address those that spike. But that spike is not the primary move. We still want to make sure that every virtual machine will get its VM happiness. Right, so if you have a overloaded cluster, we can start to move virtual machines, but then it will affect other virtual machines. Right, so VM happiness first, if possible, we'll move it out so that there's this enough room for that virtual machine to spike and to actually get its resources it needs. Does that make sense?
Duncan, you mentioned the FDM log. Is that delivered to Log Insight?
Yes. So all of the logs are actually delivered to Log Insight that are part of /log. FDM is definitely one of those, so you can leverage it. We're actually working on a pack for Log Insight as well. The engineering team already uses it. With that pack, you can quickly identify the various issues that we've discussed. It's not available yet, but I'm pushing the team to make that available because I think for a lot of customers, it's very useful. Going through the log files like I did is a lot of work. So hopefully that will be available soon.
We use it with alerts coming out.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Thanks.
Is there logging for the DRS functions, the decisions it's making? I have a DRS cluster that's moving all the time. And I'm kind of wondering why it's making those decisions.
We don't expose that type of logging directly, but we have a couple of flinks available. One of them is DRS Doctor. It's on the Flinks website. You can look at it, and it actually shows more logs, or the logs more in depth, right? So check that one out, and I think you will get a better answer.
Okay, yeah? I'm thinking that the rules are so complex that it just gets confused.
Yeah, so one of the things, and I didn't address it in this talk, but the more rules you apply, DRS rules, you restrict DRS from its options, because it has to address the rules first. That is the primary load balancing feature, and then it does the rest. So when you start to pin virtual machines or restrict movement of particular virtual machines, it needs to address this first, So in a sense, you reduce the number of options. And by that, it's likely that you get a less efficient load balancing view, right? Thanks.
So I'm just curious about the, is that working?
Yes. Yep.
You're talking about the network analysis that goes in, and if you have lots of NICs and maybe some are not being used, you excuse the numbers. Is there a way to disable certain NICs or tell it like only look at these NICs?
I'd wish. Okay. And we asked, but they're looking into it. So hopefully in a future release, we are more focused on the VM network NICs than we do now. Right?
Okay. And there is actually a session by Niels and an engineer that specifically talks about network DRS and some of the different options. So this is the type of feedback that I think the engineer would like to hear as well, because it helps them prioritizing what they should be working on and shouldn't be working on. So definitely a session you should probably attend.
Niels, when do you have it? At?
Just search for Niels Hagort, and that's a very difficult name for you guys, I realize. Just search for Niels, you'll find it.
Hi, quick question about that VM resource reduction threshold. If you set that threshold to zero in admission control policy, what will happen at that time?
For the failures to tolerate, for the performance degradation.
Yeah, with the performance.
Yeah. So if you set that to zero, then we won't tolerate any performance degradation, meaning that as soon as you hit that particular threshold and you're exceeding the amount of resources available without tolerating that performance degradation, we will inform you about it, but we won't stop you from powering on virtual machines. So this is just a warning. It's not pure admission control as the other options are. The other options are a pure admission control option where we actually stop you from powering on virtual machines. In this particular case, we will say, okay, you've hit that particular limit, you've set it to 0%, you don't want to tolerate less performance than you have before the failure. So what you probably should be doing is buying additional hosts or powering on virtual machines and moving them to a different cluster. But we won't be stopping you from powering on.
So that error message, when that error message comes up at the time of failure, or when we don't have enough resources to maintain
that? No, that will happen when you don't have sufficient resources. So we'll do that check a couple of times every hour. And if we notice that you don't have sufficient resources, we'll specify that on the clustering level. And then it's up to you to make a decision what you would like to do. Move virtual machines around, buy additional resources, or have a conversation with certain business owners that you may need to make changes to the configuration of virtual machines or whatever it is.
Okay.
So, but that's up to the user itself.
And you see it in the cluster view. So yes. It's not, you don't need to go to a particular tab. Okay. It's right there.
It's in the cluster view itself. Yeah, it's on the summary.
Will that be like, can that be sent by VROps also? Is it like APIs already exposed with VROps?
I haven't seen any integration with VROps, but I know the VROps team fairly well. So what I will do is I will take your feedback to the VROps team and ask them if they can start looking at that. Because
right.
I think
you.
That would be useful.
Yes, thank you.
I don't know. Yeah, we can take one more question.
I had an HA event in a two-node cluster with some anti-affinity rules, and it didn't restart the VM. I was just curious if you have to put the advanced setting in, or if it should violate those rules.
Were you using shoot rules or must rules?
They were must rules.
Yeah, so that it's fairly straightforward. If you use must rules, then HA needs to oblige to those particular rules. So must rules is something that we will never ever violate. Even if you use whatever advanced setting, we won't violate them as it stands today. So if virtual machines need to be restarted, then you should be using shoot rules. Now, the cool thing here is that if you use PrettyPrint with VM metadata, you can actually see the list of all the hosts that you can power on particular virtual machines on. So in this particular case, you could have gone to the command line, typed PrettyPrint to figure out why the particular virtual machine wasn't powered on. We list that in the compatibility list. So that could be something that you could be using. But you know, in the case of rules, first of all, as Frank said, try to avoid them. If you need to use them, use the shoot rules, because must rules, if anything happens to the environment and we can't power on the virtual machine because you created a must rule, then we won't be powering on the virtual machine. We will simply stop from restarting it. Until the host comes back up, then we will restart the virtual machine anyway. So
one thing I want to add, so a must rule actually impacts the compatibility list. So typically a VM has a compatibility list of all the hosts in the cluster. So if you have 10 hosts in a cluster and you say must run on host A, B, C, and D, that's listed in the compatibility list. So the rest is not listed. That means that everything looks at that compatibility list, not only DRS, not only HA, but vCenter as well. So even if you notice that that virtual machine is not running and those four hosts are not available, vCenter won't allow you actually to power it on because it's not on the compatibility list. So it's a very restrictive rule that we only recommend for the most, how can I say this? For the most stringent rules, right? So for the
compliance reasons,
that type of licensing, when you really don't want to pay somebody like Larry. So with shoot rules, always take shoot rules, because we only drop the shoot rules when something bad is happening, right? When every host in the cluster is 100% utilized. That's when we drop a shoot rule. Other than that, we don't do it. We always look for that rule. So shoot is the way to go, right?
Thank you. And with that, we'll reach the end once again. Thanks everyone for sticking around and for the questions. And make sure to pick up a free book at the Rubrik booth, right? You won't be able to get any cheaper than that. It's going to be $0, so pick it up.
Donations welcome, by the way.